Random House Audio presents Ed King by David Guterson. Read for you by Arthur Morey. Half-sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions red which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. From Shelley's Ozymandias. Far off, far down, some fisherman is watching as the rod dips and trembles over the water. Some shepherd rests his weight upon his crook, some plowman on the handles of the plowshare, and all look up in absolute amazement at those airborne above. They must be gods. From Ovid's Metamorphoses, Book 8, Daedalus and Icarus. Prologue. From King Watch, 12 days post-crash. 7:47 a.m., EST, breaking news. Ed King's flight data recorder recovered. No evidence of mechanical failure. Aircraft altitude at apex of flight, 54,500 feet. Aircraft flight ceiling, manufacturer's recommended maximum elevation, 51,000 feet. Comments? 20 words or less. King crank. Might have guessed it. King flew too high. Rule out mechanical failure. This was pilot error. Grizz pilot. I'm a pilot, and I can tell you there's no defeating physics. Must have believed he was God. Pythiamist. What a coincidence. King goes down, queen disappears. Where do you get pilot error? Rude wake up. Of course, the conspiracy theorists tab queen as culprit. Oldest story in the world. Tech trappist. She's dead, too. They've both been offed. By us or the Chinese. Take your pick. Candy Dark. Queen survives, even thrives. I say so in no uncertain terms. Tech Trappist, you're wrong. She goes on. Pythiamist. I agree with Candy Dark. Queen told her pilot to cruise to Carlisle without her, then disappeared. She had a plan. Tech Trappist. And what was that? Walk away from billions? Give me a break, Pythiamist. She's dead. Candy Dark. You must be a male, Tech Trappist. I smell dead wrong male certainty every time you hit your send key. Financy. Speaking of walking away from millions, wish I'd run, not walked, from their stock 12 days back. King Crank. Pythia's toast. Financy. I agree. History. Shanghai Roller. Deal with it, folks. Just deal with the facts. Pythia's not coming back. Chapter 1. The Affair with the Au Pair. In 1962, Walter Cousins made the biggest mistake of his life. He slept with the au pair for a month. She was an English exchange student named Diane Burroughs, and he was an actuary at Pearsall Crane Incorporated, whose wife had suffered a nervous breakdown that summer. Diane had been in his house for less than a week, mothering his kids, cleaning, making meals, when he noticed a new word intruding on his assessment of her. Here I am, thought Walter, an actuary, a guy who weighs risk for a living, and now, because I'm infatuated with the wrong person, because I'm smitten by an 18-year-old, I'm using the word fate. Diane had been peddled to Walter by an office temp familiar with her current host family as a nice girl from the UK who needs work to extend her visa. Walter, who at 34 had never left North America, thought au pair sounded pretentious. You mean babysitter, he told the temp. Immediately regretting his provincialism, he added, "I could also go with Nanny." The temp's comeback was sharp. She was younger than he was, wore formidable boots, and had an air of immunity to an office flirt like Walter. "No, definitely it's au pair," she said. "She's here on a visa. She's from out of the country. If you take her on, you become her host father and you give her an allowance for whatever she does for you. Child care or housework or whatever." Au pair it was then. Walter took down the phone number, called Diane's host mother, then spoke to the girl herself. In no position to be picky, he needed help yesterday, he hired Diane on the telephone. "This is hard to explain," he explained, "but my wife's hospitalized." Back came the sort of English inflections he couldn't help but be charmed by.
"In hospital?" she said. "I do hope it isn't serious."
"No," he said. "But meanwhile, there's the kids. 4 and 3. Barry and Tina. Out of diapers, but still, they're tricky to corral."
"Then allow me just a smidgen of shameful self-promotion. What you need is an English au pair, sir. Adept with a rodeo rope."
"I think you mean lasso."
"A lass with a lasso, then, for when they're mucking about, Starkers."
"That's what I need. Something like that."
"Well," said Diane, "I'm your girl."
This flagrantly forward use of language, neat, cunning phrases and breezy repartee, from the mouth of a high school girl jockeying for work, was new in his American ear. Diane sounded quick-witted and cheerfully combative, qualities he'd always found winning and attractive, as in her screed on the U.S. State Department and its Byzantine visa requirements.
"I'm still keen to go to college in America," she told him. "But at the moment, I'm furious with your Seattle passport office. They're trying, actually, to throw me out."
The next Sunday, with his kids complaining in the back seat of his Lincoln Premier, Walter went to escort this girl from her host family's large Victorian near Seward Park to his brick-veneered ranch house in Greenwood. He hoped Diane wouldn't be too disappointed to discover she was moving down in the world, and as he parked on the cobbles fronting the Victorian, he imagined himself apologizing for having nothing to offer in the way of gilding or ambience. Seward Park, after all, dripped old money and featured lake views. Greenwood, by contrast, was dowdy and decrepit, with summer-arid grass patches and sagging gutters. Walter, of course, would have liked a better neighborhood, but his was a notoriously mid-wage profession, a fact he hadn't reckoned with at Iowa State, but was reckoning with now, too late. Not that it was bad at Pearsall Crane, where he held down a cubicle by a window. Walter took certain consolations there, in collegial hobnobbing, in crisply dressed women, and, not least, in the higher realms of actuarial science. That the predictive power of numbers on a large scale could be brought to bear on future events, for Walter, that was like an esoteric secret and, as he put it to himself, sort of mystical. Okay, it wasn't art or philosophy, but it was still deep, which almost no one understood. When he first saw her, the au pair struck him as nowhere close to legal. She looked like a child, unfinished, a sprout. No hairdo or makeup, no jewelry, unadorned. She looked like the younger sister of a girl he'd dated long ago in high school. Her abraded leather suitcases, strapped and buckled, and riddled with tarnished rivets that looked shot from a machine gun. A matched set, though one was a junior version of the other, waited for Walter on the porch. Propped on the clasp of the larger one was a transistor radio with an ivory plastic strap and ivory knobs. Feeling like a porter, but also like a honeymooner, he hauled her overstuffed luggage to the Lincoln's trunk while Diane, in dungarees, doled out last-minute hugs and delivered farewells in her disarming accent.
"Lovely," he heard her say. "Perfect."
Then he held the car door wide for her,
and when she turned, brightly, to greet his kids in the back seat, he looked surreptitiously down the gap that opened between the rear waist of her dungarees and the nether regions of her back, at the shadow there, the practical white undies, and the reddish down along her tailbone. It was so... you never knew. You couldn't predict. Not even an actuary knew what would happen. There were broad trends, of course, which he could express in tables, but individual destinies were always nebulous. In Walter's case, this meant his wife was out of the house while he, against the odds, on a fair summer morning, was collecting up this enticing piece of luck to install in the bedroom across the hall from his. How had this dangerous but fortuitous thing happened? What had he done to deserve this risk? With these questions and her underwear in mind, he chose as his route Lake Washington Boulevard. There might be an intangible benefit in such a sinuous and scenic drive.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.